Some will say it's magic, but I know that you did all that. You're the reason, there's no doubt. Doesn't matter just how many times I tried, there could only be a single reason why. So tell me, how do miracles just happen like that, happen like that, happen like that? You can see the stars align, but I know that it's more than timing. How do miracles just happen like that, happen like that, happen like that? Right before I hit the ground, so how you came along and found me. Than time in.
How do miracles just happen like that, happen like that, happen like that?
Right before I hit the ground, so how you came along and found me. You can see the stars align, but I know that it's more than time.
Yeah. since you felt peace in the valley you made where you're not meant to be, where the shame throws shadows on you. But don't you forget that you're headed to more, but you settle for less. Don't buy the lie, it's as good as it gets. The same feet that left you lost in the
you. doing?
Morning, church.
Good. There we are. There we are. It is a beautiful day. I looked. High of 71 I have. That's exciting. You know, it's Sundays like this that kind of make me miss the drive-in services a little bit to be able to worship outside. You know, I think we might have to bring that back sometime and just do an outside service sometime. I think that'd be fun. It is a beautiful day. We are glad to be here with you to worship and to have this gathering and fellowship. I just have a couple of announcements for you this morning. CIY Superstar, it looks a little bit different this year, but they are going to be traveling up to South Dakota. Brenda and a number of students, she got a good number, just under 20 students going. And so just outside on this table here, this round table, there's some cards with little bracelets, and Brenda does this every year, and we try to do this for all our trips that we take. I encourage you to be praying for these students. And so if you want, you can grab a card on that table, and it'll have a name of a student. And it just has some ways that you can pray for them while they're on this trip. And so if you want, we would love for you to grab one of those on your way out so you can pray for a student or two, and we can just cover that trip in prayer, which would be great. Another announcement, laser tag, our encounter laser tag is coming up this month on the 20th. It's just going to be tons of fun. We're going to have it here in the gym. Junior high is from 3 to 6, and high school is from 5 to 8, and there's an hour of overlap, so we can eat supper together. But if you know a student who would enjoy hanging out and playing some laser tag, which I don't know a student who wouldn't, I have a number of adults who are like, yeah, you need chaperones, right? Please send them our way. We would love to have them at this event. It's going to be tons of fun, and I think it's just a great way to kick off the spring with a fun event like this. And then just to let you know, we had the women's conference this weekend, I wasn't here, but to my knowledge, it went extremely well. There was some powerful teaching. The women who came and participated loved it and enjoyed it, and so we are just really thankful that we were able to do that and that those who were able to come were able to be blessed through it and just were able to gather some good information and some different community stuff through that event. But let me pray, and then we'll go into our time of worship for this morning. Dear God, we thank you so much just for this time that we can gather here and just worship you, that we can focus in on you, and that's what this time is about. It's about either ending our week or starting our week with you. Help us do that. Help us focus in. Help us glorify you, God. Help us praise you with our voices and with the songs that we're about to sing. Let this be a time that we can just enjoy what we are able to do together as a body of believers. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Good morning, family. How are we doing this morning? Good, good. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Matt. I'm one of the interim worship leaders here at Whiting Christian Church. We're so glad that you've taken the time out of your morning to meet us here at church. And then for those of you who are watching online, welcome. We're glad that you're watching online as well. Why don't we stand up this morning and do some singing?
Stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Cross. a son and daughter, the King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of Glory, the King above all kings.
Say a quick hello to someone you haven't seen in a little bit of time. We'll be right with you.
Good morning. How are you doing? Yeah, that's Ben's daughter. Yeah. Aria. So, yeah, she's pretty cool.
We're going to continue on worshiping this morning.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love. The sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. A slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. And the sun in my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Whom the sun sets free, oh, is free.
Sing it with me again.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Lift this up with me. Father God, will your kingdom come here this morning? Lord, we are so thankful for your kingdom that's coming. Lord, that your son who's been here, who plans on coming again. Lord, would you meet us here in this place? Would you open our hearts to Josh's message this morning? Will you please speak through him? Will you bless us through his words today? Lord, please meet us here. In your son's name, amen. You guys may be seated.
Well, hello again, church. You know, I hope over this weekend, the last couple days, that you've had a chance to be out and to enjoy this weather. Yesterday, while Sammy was here for the women's conference, Magnolia and I were able to spend a decent amount of time outside. We went to the park in the morning to play disc golf, and I say we because it's like, hey, Dad's going to go do this, and so you're going to come with me. And so we went, and she does have fun, and we went and played outside for a little bit. And then in the afternoon, we came to the playground here in town, and we played in the park on the playground for a little bit, and we played in the yard with the dogs. We spent a lot of time, and it was a good day. Now, it's Iowa, so I highly doubt the bad weather is behind us. But I do love this glimpse of spring. This glimpse of spring. The trees budding, the geese flying back north. The snow is almost gone. We can spend more than 15 minutes outside without having to worry about frostbite. You know, nice things like that. But last night, I had to run outside to get something out of our yard. And while I was outside, I looked up and I saw, you know, all the stars in the sky. And I was able, you know, it wasn't cold out, so I wasn't trying to run in and get back inside. And so I paused, and, you know, I was able to just look at the stars for a little bit. And it reminded me of one of my favorite passages of Scripture, which is Psalm 8. Now, Psalm 8, it has this important literary structure in it that's known as a chiasm. Now, basically, the way we were taught chiasms in college is to think of them like a sandwich. It's bookended, usually the passage is bookended by the same thing. And so Psalm 8, what this is there's a phrase, and it begins and ends with the same phrase. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And so what we were taught is when we see the buns of the sandwich, there's a very important question that we have to ask, and it's where's the meat? Where's the meat? Because the important part's in the middle. And here in Psalm 8, here's the important part, the middle two lines. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. You've made them a little lower than angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You see, before these middle lines and after these middle lines, the psalmist has been talking about the incredible work of God in creation. That he made all the stars in the sky, the animals that run across this earth, right? All the things that we could go out and appreciate on a beautiful spring day like today are the things of the works of our God. Yet what we see is that with an entire universe to take care of, God takes special care of us. And he gives us a place of glory and honor. And as we talked about a few weeks ago, we are the only thing in creation made in the image of God. And now it's not that he doesn't just care about us as a whole, right? He does care about us as a whole, but more than that, he cares about us as an individual. Yes, God cares about mankind, but God also cares about Jed. He cares about Josh, Dave, Larry. Cares about all of us as individuals. A universe to take care of, to watch over, to make sure that things keep on spinning. Yet with all of that, God's never busy enough to say, hey, I care about you. To love us as humans, as beings made in his image. And so during these beautiful days, as we're able to look at God's creation and see the beauty in it, I'm reminded that he takes special care of me, which is why he sent his son down to die for us. Yes, to save all mankind, but also for us as individuals. Will you pray with me? Dear God, that phrase, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. You are spectacular, God, in the way that you watch over us, that you give us individual care and treatment. Us humans who constantly make mistakes, who constantly do things that go against your desire for us, yet despite that, you have this incredible love for us. a love that was perfectly personified in your Son, who came to this world to die for us, to go to the cross for his body to be broken and his blood to be spilled. Yes, for us as a whole, but also for us as individuals, so that when I make a mistake, I know that you still care for me. God, you are good, and we love you. It's in Jesus' name that I pray, amen. So if you want, you can take the communion cup now, and you can take the little wafer, that's the bread, represents Jesus' body, and the juice represents his blood. So as we come to this time of offering, you know, this time of COVID has been particularly hard on students who, you know, very much for their development rely on structure and discipline. And that's just kind of been, you know, the structure side of things has just been thrown wonky this year. And, you know, for students who, you know, even though they grow up in a technological age, you know, to have to be separated from friends and family for periods of time like that, it's hard on them. And so to be able to go and have events and trips like the Superstart and the laser tag, it's just huge. To get kids out of the house, to say, hey, come hang out together, let's do something fun. That's huge for them during this time. And thankfully, because of your generosity and the way that you give that, you know, Brendan and I, the way we run our ministries, we're able to do these things, to go on the trip like Superstart, or to have these events like Laser Tag, where students have these opportunities to get out of the house and to have an actual physical connection with people again. And that's just, that's huge for them. And so we thank you so much for your continued support. And if you can't tell by now, we are continually wanting to bring new ways that your giving impacts this church every week, because it does. And we want to make sure that you see that it is going to good places, that it is being used for good purposes, and it is accomplishing things for the kingdom of God and to impact the lives of those around us. And so we thank you for your giving. If you would like to give this morning, we do have the box there in the back that you can drop a donation in. Or if you want, you can go online and sign up to give through our online website. But with that being said, let me pray, and then I'll welcome Josh up to share the message with us this morning. Dear God, we thank you for this time that we can listen to a message from your word and allow it to impact our lives, that It's something that we can not just hear, but do. And we're excited to learn about how you built a kingdom. You built a kingdom, and that you have done that through your people, and that and the amazing things that were accomplished through that kingdom and continue to be accomplished through your kingdom on this earth, God. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Good morning. How y'all doing? Oh my goodness, I love this weather. I'm driving down, and I'm just like, I have to keep my eye on the road because I'm so transfixed by the huge flocks of geese. Like, it's crazy to me. Like, I've never seen flocks of white geese that are like thousands of birds. Like, to you, you're probably thinking, it's like, oh, that's crazy. To me, that was just beautiful. So, whatever. Anyway, hey, I got my card in the front of the worship space. I want to encourage you to grab yours too. This is my bracelet, my card to pray for a student. Well, my bracelet doesn't really fit on my wrist, so I kind of adapted and overcome. It's a ring now. But I'm going to be praying during this trip. I think it's awesome to really cover our students in prayer and cover our leaders in prayer as they go on these trips and really experience Jesus. So I got mine. I encourage you to get yours on your way out, and they're by that little black table on the way out of the worship space. Well, hey, folks, we've been in this series that we're calling The Big Picture because we believe that the Bible in its entirety is a story, a long, winding, complex story about God and his people and how it ultimately leads towards Jesus. Jesus is the target, is the destination of the book. And so we've been going through various important moments in the biblical history and talk about how Jesus is reflected in those moments. We started this by talking about Adam and Eve. We talked about creation and Adam and Eve and how their failure would not come to define humanity. It certainly would set us back, but it wouldn't define humanity. We knew that that God's last word was going to be in crushing the serpent and in dealing with the deception. Last week, we talked about God's promise to Abraham and how God's promises are secure and how he promised that through Abraham's act of courage and devotion and faith, an entire nation would be born. And then even beyond that, that through that nation, all of the people on earth would be blessed. Well, we're going to fast forward the clock a little bit. We're going to be talking about the kingdom, but we kind of got to fill in some historical gaps here. See, after Abraham, what happened is the Abraham's children, Abraham's family, eventually their descendants got through a couple generations later, they end up as slaves in Egypt. And as slaves in Egypt, they are mistreated and they call out to God. And after years and years, generation after generation after generation of being mistreated by the Egyptians, they are released from slavery through Moses. This is the Ten Commandments. This is the plagues of Egypt, the thing that Charlton Heston, let my people go. That's that story. And so after that, they leave Egypt, they cross the Red Sea, they get the Ten Commandments, and then they get told that they're on their way to the Promised Land, and they go into the desert to wander to the Promised Land. But they wander for 40 years because of their sin. And so they're wandering for 40 years in the desert until eventually they end up in the Promised Land. And this is when you see Joshua in the Battle of Jericho, a personal favorite of mine. and so the people of God step into the Promised Land, they conquer the cities, and they establish themselves in this land that God has set aside for them. But see, they were very different from the other peoples around them, because at least on the surface, it looked like Israel, or the people of God, had no real king. You see, the structure of ancient Israel, the structure of God's people at this time, the way they kind of gathered themselves and organized themselves, they didn't have a traditional king or ruler like you and I would think of. Technically, God, Yahweh, was king, and that's not just church lingo. For the people of God in this time, the people in the Promised Land, literally, God was king. He was the king on the throne. He was the one who ruled over their country. And the will of Yahweh, the will of King God, was kind of administered the people through three different roles. And we see that all throughout the Old Testament. These roles are of priests. Priests are the ones who, you know, maintained the practice of worship, maintained the temple, and oversaw kind of the acts of worship of the people. Then you had the role of the prophets. The prophets' role was to speak the will of God, speak the word of God into the people, and teach them what God has to say to them. And then you had the judges, and judges were very interesting. They were individual leaders raised up for a very specific purpose at a very specific time to lead the people through a specific crisis. Okay? So you had these three roles of priests, prophet, and judge, all serving King God. And that weird kind of political structure is how the people of God existed for hundreds of years. And if you're a nerd like me and love this history stuff, I highly recommend reading about the priests, prophets, and judges. I would love to go into it here, but I'd probably bore about half of you. It's super interesting, and I highly recommend taking a look at it. But that you just need to understand that this is the world that we're stepping into right now. All right, you have this whole people living in this promised land. They're definitely a one people group because they have this kind of unique identity, but they don't necessarily have a traditional political structure with the king. Instead, God is very much seen as king, and his will is communicated through priests, prophets, and judges. And then we meet an interesting dude. His name is Samuel. And we're going to actually be spending a lot of our time today in the books of 1 and 2 Samuel. Samuel is a very interesting guy in the biblical history because Samuel seems to operate as high priest, as prophet, and in some cases even as judge. So he tends to operate as all three, but he is not king. He is not the ruler of Israel. Remember, God is the ruler of God's people. But at this time, in this this place that we're going to be stepping into the narrative, Samuel is kind of acting in all three of those roles. And the people are starting to get tired of their situation. They're seeing how different they are from the other nations. And so here we are. We're in 1 Samuel chapter 8, starting in verse 4, and we'll have it on the screen behind me. So the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. And they said to him, "You are old." Don't you love that opening? It's like, well, thank you. Awesome. Great. Bye. No. He goes, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways." Now, Samuel had two kids that he wanted to inherit kind of his practices, but they weren't really followers of God, at least not in the way that Samuel was. "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us." Remember, they already have a king, so now they're saying, no, we want a human king, such as all the other nations have. We want to look like all the other nations. Verse 6, "But when they said, 'Give us a king to lead us,' this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord told him, 'Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you that they have rejected. Remember, you're not the ruler of Israel. I am. It's not you that they rejected, but they have rejected me as their king, as they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods as they are doing now to you." Now, this entire history of Israel, God pulled them out of slavery and he saved them and they were great. They followed God and then they messed up and they started following other gods and they got into trouble, and then God raised up a judge and they followed God and they kept it in the cycle over and over and over again. That's kind of what God is talking about. In fact, the word Israel literally means struggles with God. So anyway, "Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly, and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." In other words, God is saying, look, they're asking for a king. The people are asking for a king because they've rejected me as their king. So go ahead and give them a king. But I want you to give them one last chance. Explain to them what they're getting themselves into by putting their faith and following in a person rather than me. So Samuel goes on to warn the people that having a king is not what's best for them. They already have a great king, all right? They have God. They have the greatest king in the universe, that appointing a human is a step down. But the people, they persist. No, no, we see kings. We see kings in all these other nations. That's what we understand. We want a king. You're the one in charge. Give us a king. And so Samuel gives in. And so Samuel crowns Israel's first king. Israel's first king is a guy named Saul. Saul is awesome. He's this amazing warrior, amazing tactician, wins a whole bunch of battles. He's an awesome dude. He's a great dude. All right? He's a skilled warrior, this great leader at first. Saul begins to, over his time of rule, he lets the power go to his head, and he starts second-guessing God's commands. And when God tells him to go in and take a city, he's like, do I really need to? And he starts second-guessing what God's telling him. Eventually, this power goes to his head so much that he becomes jealous of another individual who's serving in his court, who is gaining a lot of attention and is a great servant and a great leader of men and a great soldier. This man named David. He becomes so jealous of David that he becomes increasingly irrational, and at one point even tries to pin David to the wall by throwing a spear at him. He conspires to murder David and anyone else that he sees as getting in his way. Now, for this and a whole bunch of reasons, God's favor eventually goes away from Saul. So here's Israel's first king, Saul. And then David eventually becomes king. And David is a mighty warrior. He has a strong faith. He's often described as a man after God's own heart. This is the guy who, as a child, killed Goliath, the greatest soldier that the Philistines could muster. And he killed him with a sling. He's a hero. He's a bold, faithful follower of Yahweh. He's a man who loves God. And actually, under King David, the kingdom of Israel prospers. And it goes into this golden age of a kingdom. And this great kingdom begins to expand. And their lands go out. And they're a land that is defined by their unwavering devotion to Yahweh. In fact, David was such a good king that he becomes the standard that all future kings are measured against. However, even David faltered. Now I'm going through a lot of history here real quick. Even David faltered. David had a secret affair with a woman named Bathsheba, the wife of one of his soldiers, Uriah. And when she becomes pregnant, he tries to cover up the affair. Tries to set up a situation where it looks like it's Uriah's child. It doesn't work. And when that is no longer possible, he engineers Uriah's death in battle. So now we're in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 14. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab, one of his generals, and sent it with Uriah to the front. And in it he wrote, put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest. Then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die. Verse 16, so while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah in the place where he knew the strongest defenders were. He set him up. And when the men of the city came out and fought against Joab, some of the men of David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite was dead. David killed Uriah. He didn't swing the sword, but he killed Uriah in an attempt to cover up his own sin. He eventually marries Bathsheba and claims the child as his own. But these sins come back to sow chaos and destruction in David's household, and then eventually in the country as a whole. and David and Bathsheba's son, who was conceived out of this sin, dies. And it sends David into a deep grief. And historians argue that this period of time is what set in motion some of the instability that followed. And this is the pace that was set for kings to come. Then after David, there was another king. There was Solomon. Solomon was a great and powerful king. He had God's favor. He finished the temple. He had success upon success. He was the wealthiest man to ever live. And then over time, he fell into sin. Had hundreds of wives and started allowing the worship of other gods. And it just got worse after that. Then there was a civil war and the kingdom split, divided into north and south. And king after king after king through the generations struggled to keep the kingdom on track to honoring God's ways. Because that was the identity of these people. They were supposed to follow King Jesus. And now for generations, they were following a man who was trying, who was supposed to get the people to follow God. And he failed. Over and over and over again through the generations. Generation after generation, the kings got worse and they led Israel further astray, away from God, over and over and over again. But the people still remembered this short period of time early in the reign of King David where the kingdom seemed powerful and faithful and on key and on target. This became the golden age, and people watched as their kingdom slowly fell apart around them, generation after generation. And the people yearned to go back to the time of King David. This is a lot of history of Israel, but it's important to understand because this moment sets up arguably one of the most important aspects of the psychology of God's people at the time of Jesus. This looking back on this time when everything was seemed good, but it was marred by human failure. But that begs the question too, when you look at this line of kings, where do you put your faith? Where do we put our faith? Because I tell you, when I look at culture, we sure do love our kings, don't we? We love our kings. We don't call them kings. That's not cool anymore. The title king in our modern world really isn't that good anymore. We tend to avoid that word. Instead, we call them athletes. We call them celebrities. We call them politicians, influencers. We have lots of kings. We line up to follow them. We form political parties. We form fandoms. We form teams. We try to emulate our kings. We read about and watch their battles unfold. Now, arguably, they're not battles over cities or on the open field with swords and shield. Usually, they're spats between politicians or a recent a marriage breakup or a game on a football field. But we just soak that stuff up, don't we? As human beings, we love kings because we love heroes. Because they show us that success is possible. That even when it feels like the world doesn't make sense, that there are those who are able to achieve greatness. They're able to achieve power, wealth, skill beyond what we can do right now. We love our kings. And as long as they can do that, it's still possible for us, right? So their wins become our wins, and their defeats become our defeats. But people are far from perfect, and our kings will almost always fail us at some point in time, just like Israel. Underneath the wealth and the glory, the press conferences and the public relations team, our kings are still human. They have the same uncertainties, they have the same selfish ambitions, and the same desires for achievement as we do. The same imperfections, the same flaws. Which means that our kings, are just as susceptible to failure as we are. And sure enough, our media is full of stories of our fallen kings. Affairs, corruption, addiction, arrests. It's almost impossible to scroll through your Facebook feed or walk by the magazine aisle in the grocery store without seeing the exploits of our fallen kings. Do not place your faith, I cannot stress this enough, do not place your faith in kings, at least not these kind. Not in earthly kings, not in human kings, not in heroes. Do not place your faith in people. Don't get me wrong. We can celebrate people. We can love people. We can celebrate the achievements. We can learn from the achievements. We can have camaraderie and build around those achievements. We can cheer them on, celebrate, and cry with their defeats. By all means, yes, people are wonderful. Love them. But that's not where our identity comes from. We shouldn't be placing our faith in people, in our modern kings. Our identity should not rest on the success and failure of a team, or of a politician, or a celebrity, or an influencer. You are worth so much more than that. You're worth so much more than being defined by someone else's actions. So back to David for a second. Early in David's reign, God made him a promise. And it's important to realize this, because God made a great promise, and it's a promise that we are reaping today. And you can find it in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 and 13. This is the God talking. This is God talking. And he says, "The Lord declares to you, the Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you." And then verse 12, "When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you." Okay, we've seen that. "Your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom." Okay. "He is the one who will build a house for my name." All right, well, Solomon finished the temple, sure. "And I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." Wait a second. Solomon didn't live forever. In fact, none of the kings lived forever. And in fact, the country of Israel fell apart within a couple generations and split in civil war. So what's he talking about? Establish the throne of his king forever, of his kingdom forever. And now, understand, we've learned from Abraham that God's promises are secure. God's promises are absolutely true, and if God promises it, it's going to happen. It may not happen in the time frame that we expect, but it will happen the way God says it will. It's more true than the ground underneath your feet. So what are we talking about? This promise is echoed generations and generations later by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah delivered this prophetic statement from God on the eve of Israel's darkest hour. Isaiah is speaking at the end of this whole time period, as the kings are failing and Israel's about to be conquered by a foreign power. And it's here that Isaiah delivers these words from God to encourage Israel upon seeing their country fall apart. We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 11. And he says, "A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse." Jesse is David's father. "And his roots, a branch, will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The Spirit of wisdom and of understanding. The Spirit of counsel and of might. The Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with his rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, faithfulness the sash around his waist. So far we're painting a picture of an amazing king from David's line at a time when the kings are failing and Israel's about to end. Verse 6, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and the little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, the young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. Peace. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hands into the viper's nest. No fear. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And verse 10, in that day, the root of Jesse, in other words, someone from David's line, will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. So in other words, Isaiah gets up and he talks to the people after seeing, after generation and generation, seeing their country, seeing their people fall apart and fall into chaos. He gets up and he says, do not worry, a king who is coming, a king from David's family is coming, and he's going to be better than even David. He's going to have divine wisdom. He's going to have divine judgment, help the poor, bring an era of peace like you've never seen, not just for Israel, but for the entire world. Don't be disheartened. Now, on this side of history, we know who he's talking about. He's talking about Jesus. Jesus, who from the line of David was born in Bethlehem. Jesus, being fully God and also fully human, who experienced our temptation, experienced every level of temptation that we experience, yet remained perfect and pure and sinless. Jesus, the perfect King. God himself, who loves you so much that the perfect king was willing to die so that you could be saved. And then, as the perfect king conquers death itself, we know who Isaiah is talking about. The only king worthy of worship. The only king that's worth following. So where do you put your faith? Do you put your faith in humans, in failure, or do you put your faith in divine perfection? In human ambition and success and achievement, or on the security of God's promises? Don't put your faith in me. I'm a dude. Put your faith in Jesus. All right? We are all part of building this new kingdom. God is building a kingdom. He started building that kingdom, as Matt said, 2,000 years ago when he ushered in the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He started that 2,000 years ago, but he's still doing it now. All nations are going to be a part of this kingdom. All nations will be blessed through what God has to say in this kingdom. We do this, we build this kingdom by resting on the promises of God, not the promises of kings. We have to have eyes to see our neighbors, to truly see our neighbors, to see their needs, both physical, emotional, and spiritual. We have to have the boldness to live on mission, to live in such a way that we honor God with every step we take. Because it's not about us, it's about Him. God is building a kingdom now. Jesus is our King. And He's building His kingdom here, now, through you, through us, today. Let's pray. Dear Father God, build your kingdom here. Build your kingdom here. Build it in us. Use us. We're not going to let our lives be identified by human failure, because that's not who we are. We're yours. We're children of you. We're children of God. We're not slaves to fear. We're children of God. We're children of you. And we know that you can do anything. You can do everything. So God, we're not going to put our faith in human kings. We're going to put our faith in you. And God, build your kingdom here. Build it in Whiting. Build it in Sloan. Build it in Ottawa. Build it in Iowa. Build it in Nebraska. Build it here. Through us. Show us what we need to do. Give us the eyes to see our neighbors. Give us the boldness to be able to live on mission and reflect your light in all our relationships. To point to you, not to us, not to human achievement and human imperfection, but to you, to perfection, to divine knowledge, to divine love. Use us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much, Josh. Appreciate it. So we're going to do something a hair bit different than what we've done in previous services. We're going to bring a throwback back, and I have one question for you all. Are you ready to engage in some shindiggery? So we are going to build this kingdom here, and we just would ask that you would stand with us this last morning, this last song as we sing, and we ask that you just try your best and keep up.
Ready?
All right. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. Oh, we pray. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil while we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like fire within our very souls. Holy Spirit, come and invade us now. We are your church, and we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our life. Captives' hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. And we lay down our lives for heaven's cause. And we are your church, and we revive this earth. Build your kingdom. Build your kingdom. Let your darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Seal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty changing hearts. You made us one more, much more than this, so away.
kingdom seed in us built. The strength, and love of Christ. And we are your church, and we are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here. We pray. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and our land. Set your church on fire, lend this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here. We pray.
Amen. It has been an absolute honor and pleasure to be able to worship with you guys this morning. We will see you next week. Take care.